Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The portfolio on this occasion is transport. I invite members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant questions. There is quite a bit of interest, so brevity in questions and responses as far as possible would be appreciated. And I call question number one, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking, including through discussion with the UK Government, to ensure that rail services are safe and accessible for all.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Whilst both rail safety and accessibility are reserved to the UK Government, the Scottish Government has fully funded the Office of Rail and Roads' independent determination of Network Rail's cost to deliver a safe and high-performing network. Officials at Transport Scotland meet regularly with representatives from the Department for Transport and Network Rail to discuss various matters, including safety and accessibility, and only last week I met with the Chair of Network Rail Board and the Chair of Office of Rail and Road Board to discuss how the Scottish Minister's requirements will be delivered by Network Rail.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Anyone who regularly uses the railway will have witnessed the benefit of having a safety-critical guard on the train. I personally received invaluable assistance recently in supporting a young female passenger who was being harassed by an older male. I know the Scottish Government is committed to ensuring that public transport is safe and accessible for all and is particularly mindful of the challenges faced by women and girls travelling alone. Will the Cabinet Secretary use her influence to implore publicly owned ScotRail to show that they are too and to keep the guard on ScotRail?
Cabinet Secretary.
While staffing is generally a matter for ScotRail as the employer, the Scottish Government continues to specify a requirement that all ScotRail services should have a second staff member on board to assist passengers. I can also say that Transport Scotland is taking forward with stakeholders the 10 recommendations from the work on women and girls' safety in public transport. I can also relay that ScotRail's Travel Safe team are being successful in their operation and are doing patrols, particularly with British Transport Police, and they're doing joint patrols when there are areas of antisocial behaviour that can cause difficulties.
Thank you. And brief supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The ScotRail high-speed trains reportedly contributed to the tragic outcomes at Carmen as they're less safe than modern standards. The Cabinet Secretary and her predecessors consistently refused to give me a date for replacement, and many suggest that's due to the cost of the break clause in the contract with the Rosco. Could the Cabinet Secretary confirm, do financial considerations play any part at all in the refusal to replace these HSTs?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say very politely to Liam Kerr, he raised a similar point recently and he was wrong and misrepresented the findings of the Carmarthen Board in relation to those trains. What I can say, though, in terms of the aspects of replacement, that is an active consideration. We are engaging on fleet replacement and will, of course, inform Parliament at the due point. So, therefore, in relation to his point, it's not about cost. It is a recognition that we need to replace those trains in line with other aspects, including, as he knows, the decarbonisation of the line Aberdeen South. But I would implore him, and I've written to him, I'm not sure he's received the letter, correcting him in his misunderstanding. I think it's really wrong to misrepresent that Carmarthen Safety Board and its recommendations.
Question two, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will revisit the feasibility of a bus lane corridor on the northbound M77 into Glasgow.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The second Strategic Transport Projects Review published in 2022 recommends that bus priority interventions are implemented within Scotland's cities and towns where congestion is at its highest. This recommendation seeks to implement schemes targeted at delivering faster and more reliable journey times for bus passengers. In the case of the trunk road and motorway network, Transport Scotland will build on the current work progressing plans for the bus priority in the M8, M77 and M80. This work remains under development, in particular considering the changes in travel patterns post-COVID and wider policy priorities.
Willie Coffey.
I thank the Minister for that answer. With the news confirmed yesterday that over £1 billion has been cut from our capital budget by the UK Government, and no prospect of that being reinstated by any future UK Government, how can we make progress in Scotland with projects like this and park and ride facilities too that would really help us to encourage more commuters out of their cars and onto the excellent bus services that we offer?
Minister.
I call you for that response. This government is committed to improving public transport to encourage modal shift, which in turn would result in a reduction of car-based trips and associated emissions. Bus priority measures at appropriate locations have potential to deliver greater punctuality and reduce journey times and offer a competitive alternative to the private car, particularly where the measures include interchange with other public transport services and active travel. The second Strategic Transport Project review also recommends a framework for delivery of mobility hubs to enhance transport interchanges and accessibility services.
Brief supplementary, Brian Whitt.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister quite rightly highlights pinch points in and out of a city to deliver a successful bus lane usage. But he also recognised along the A77 there are other pinch points, like at the Belfield interchange, where 41% of traffic in and out of North Ayrshire travel through. And I'm sure my colleague Sharon Dowie would mention the Dutch House roundabout and other roundabouts along that route. If we don't get them right, unfortunately, a bus lane will not be practical.
Minister.
As I say, there is ongoing work to look at. The Transport Scotland are looking at areas right across the country, and once that review is complete, then we will be able to have better answers for that.
Question 3, Russell Findlay.
Just the Scottish Government, whether it will provide an update on how it plans to support local authorities to address the issues of potholes in the road network.
Cabinet Secretary.
I appreciate the road maintenance challenges across Scotland and the importance of a safe, well-performing road network. However, local road maintenance is the responsibility of local authorities, who allocate resources on the basis of local priorities. The 2024-25 local government settlement provides record funding over £14 billion to local authorities, including £144 million of funding for the council tax freeze. This represents an increase of £795.7 million. Ultimately, it is for locally elected representatives to make local decisions on how best to deliver services to their local communities.
Russell Findlay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Now, roads in my West of Scotland region are in a dangerous state of disrepair, just as they are across Scotland. One in four constituents replying to my annual report say that potholed and poor conditions are their main concern, with one Paisley resident telling me that cratered local roads are like the surface of the moon. Now, the SNP have slashed council budgets year after year, so surely the Cabinet Secretary can admit that her government must fill council's funding gap so that they can fill the potholes.
Cabinet Secretary.
All on the day after that autumn statement that provided no capital and support for the Scottish Government, but I'm not going to diminish people's experience of roads. We all understand that as MSPs. But I think if you referred to the Scottish Local Government Finance Statistics for 2022-23, the net revenue expenditure by local authorities on roads maintenance increased by 12.2% from the £143 million in 21-22 to £161 million in 22-23. And that was an increase of £18 million. So there is an issue how local authorities spend their funding, but on those statistics, despite difficult circumstances, local authorities actually spent more, significantly more, on the road maintenance than the year before.
Supplementary, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary wish, as I do, that the Tories would explain to us how the Scottish Government is supposed to support local authorities to address potholes as they ask, when their party are utterly content to see Scotland's budget slashed by their Westminster masters? And does she agree that this sort of gaslighting is why the people of Scotland will never elect them to run this country?
Cabinet Secretary.
I completely agree. There is no credibility for the Conservative Party to come to this chamber and ask for money for this government to give to local authorities at a time when they're absolutely providing no increase and taking 10% out of our capital budget over the next 10 years. I think they live in some kind of parallel universe.
Question 4, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the Bus Partnership Fund, including what the spending plans are for the £473.1 million that is reportedly unspent to date and when the fund will be resumed.
Minister.
Following the UK autumn statement, delivering the worst-case scenario for Scotland and a nearly 10% real terms cut that my colleague has just mentioned here in our capital budget from the UK Government, the Scottish Government had to take the difficult decision to deliver a balanced and sustainable spending plan for 24-25. As such, regrettably, the Bus Partnership Fund has been paused for 24-25. However, future funding availability will be considered as part of our annual budget setting process and prioritisation exercises.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister fairly for that answer. Since the pandemic, Lifeline bus services, particularly those in rural areas such as the borders, have come under significant pressure because of increased operating costs and reduced revenue income. Some operators have withdrawn services completely in rural areas, affecting young people and elderly people. Presiding Officer, a temporary pause in direct funding for the Bus Partnership Fund is disastrous for the future of rural bus travel. So therefore, will Jim Fairley tell me where the funding has gone, and will he reinstate, or when will he reinstate, the direct funding for the Bus Partnership Fund to ensure that rural local authorities and transport operators can continue to provide vital rural transport links?
Minister.
The parallel universe that Fiona Hislop was just talking about has been said again. The budget has been cut by £1.6 billion. You cannot magic money out of the air. So the Scottish Government will continue to put the priorities that it can to make sure that rural... And I am absolutely not minimising rural bus users' difficulties. I fully understand that. But we cannot magic money out of nowhere. And if the budget is continuously cut, what will happen is services are going to be frozen. So we will come to the decision about how we're going to get these things back in line once we can put budgets back in place without the savage cuts that we're facing currently from Westminster Tories.
Can I remind the Chamber that we will listen to the questions with courtesy and respect, and we will listen to the responses with the same courtesy and respect. There are a number of supplementaries. I'll try to get them all in. They'll need to be brief, as will the responses. First, John Swinney.
President Officer, did the Minister hear the Finance Secretary say during the budget process that she had received no alternative proposals in the budget process from the Conservatives? And as a consequence, the proposition that's just been put to the Minister is laughable because the finances cannot be delivered to support it because of the cuts to the Scottish Government's budget by the United Kingdom Government budget.
Minister.
I absolutely agree, but I think we always need to come back to the point that this affects people. When we cut budgets, when we've had these things happen, it's Rachel Hamilton's constituents, it's my constituents, it's John Swinney's constituents who feel the brunt of it. So we've got to be able to find a way of being able to work together to get these budgets back in so that we can provide the services that we want to provide.
Alec Rowley.
Presiding Officer, I've spoke to SPTs, SESTRANS and many individual local authorities who between them must have put in hundreds of millions of pounds worth of bids for this fund. Does the Minister accept that it is crucial that we have this investment if we're going to get the bus services up to a point where people will want to leave the car at home and use them? And therefore, can we ensure that we prioritise this budget as part of the overall strategy to get more people out of public transport and into buses?
Minister.
There's a lot of stuff that Alec Rowley is saying I could absolutely agree with. Of course we want to get more public transport. We want to get people into buses, exactly as he says. The fund is paused. The government hasn't said that it's not going to continue at a later year. If we can get our budgets back to where we would like them to be after the cuts that they've faced, then that is what this government will do. Absolutely committed to bus travel working for the people of Scotland.
And briefly, Willie Rennie.
When the SNP came to power, there were almost half a billion journeys on the buses every year. Over the following decade, it dropped by 100 million before dropping further since the pandemic. So for the years before the autumn statement, why did the government fail to spend the budget that was designed to reverse that decline?
Minister.
I very much hear what Willie Rennie is saying, but he completely forgot to talk about the pandemic, the fallen numbers of bus users that have happened during the pandemic. But let me give you one example. In the south of Scotland alone, over 180,000 people benefit from free bus travel, making over 460,000 journeys in the last month alone. We are absolutely committed to trying to do everything we can to maintain bus service in Scotland, and it would be really helpful if our budgets didn't continuously get slashed.
Question 5, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support ferry users in light of reports that MV Caledonian Isles will be out of action for 4 more months.
Cabinet Secretary.
The delay of the MV Caledonian Isles returning from essential dry docking is regrettable, and I recognise the frustration felt by the island communities as a result. I spoke with CalMAC's chief executive last week to convey my concern. I've been clear that I expect CalMAC to apply the revised route matrix, the route prioritisation matrix, which includes more emphasis on the level of use by island residents and commercial vehicles, along with higher priorities for routes with limited capacity on alternative services. The Arran community and others across the network need those assurances, particularly as we look towards the Easter break and beyond. Meanwhile, the Arran is being served by the MV Isle of Arran, with currently no capacity issues being reported.
Katie Clark.
As the Cabinet Secretary knows, the Arran route is the busiest service, with islanders, tourism and the wider economy heavily reliant on it. The Isle of Arran will not have the capacity needed to provide the service as the year progresses, as the Cabinet Secretary, I think, has already alluded to. So in her discussions, what has been said in terms of how capacity can be increased on the route as the year progresses?
Cabinet Secretary.
So that was one of the messages I gave to CalMAC in terms of the capacity issues, particularly for the highly used service to Arran. And indeed, that is part of their activities, is to identify if there are other measures, alternative measures, that for the July-August period, particularly, there can be some improvement in capacity for Arran to help support that holiday season.
And very briefly, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And tourism perception is critical. Irresponsible comments by Tory List MSPs that the ferry service is catastrophic does nothing to convey the reality that Arran is open for business. CalMAC's making 11th-hour efforts to maximise capacity on the Ardrossan to Brodick route with MV Isle of Lewis berthing trials, the results of which won't be known till next week. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that Arran's community must be fully briefed on these trials so that they can plan effectively for Easter?
As briefly as possible,
Cabinet. So these berthing trials are part of that attempt to identify if there are other ways to improve capacity. But I completely agree with the Kenneth Gibson's sentiment that despite these challenges, Arran and all our islands are very much open for business this Easter. And it's important that we will take responsibility to make sure that we all take responsibility to make sure that our messaging is clear on this, including in commentary in this chamber and indeed by others in the press.
Thank you. Question six, Shan Berry.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the reopening of the train line south of Ayr in light of the fire at Ayr Station Hotel.
Cabinet Secretary.
The restoration of rail services, including south of Ayr, is dependent on the completion of works to make the Ayr Station Hotel building safe, which South Ayrshire Council is responsible for. I understand the Council leader may have suggested dates when the rail services will be restored, but on what basis is not clear. This was inadvisable, as he was no locus to do so, and I was clear when I met him that he must not take on that role of speaking for the rail authorities. Announcement of when there is restoration of rail services can only be for Network Rail and ScotRail to advise, and only when the Council's works to make the hotel safer completed will the rail industry be able to get access to carry out the necessary works to enable the restoration of services. Once there is certainty around the completion date for the safety-related works, Scotland's Railway will start to communicate the timings for services being restored.
Sharon Debbie.
Thank you. The line being closed is having a huge impact on visitor numbers to Ayr and to the surrounding local economy. The Scottish Grand National will be Ayr Racecourse on the 20th of April, when well over 20,000 racegoers will be coming to Ayr for the weekend. The Grand National supports a lot of jobs, gives a substantial boost to many Ayrshire businesses and is a major event for the local economy. It's imperative the railway is open before it starts, as the current arrangements are totally inadequate, especially that no trains can travel south. What action is being taken now to reopen the line, and will the Minister guarantee the railway will be back to normal before the Scottish Grand National
Week? Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member really has to take a level of responsibility. The railways can only open when they are safe to do so. And I think it's really imperative that all of us are considered in our remarks about when that rail service can be open. I hear what she says about the Grand National. It's one of the biggest days of the year in Ayr. I remember waitressing on the day and how busy the town was with people coming in. What I can say to the member is we will identify with all our colleagues across Transport Scotland how we can support the transportation to Ayr to ensure that there's a successful Scottish Grand National that day.
Okay, question 7, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government what factors are assessed when determining vessel deployment decisions for Western Isles ferry routes.
Cabinet Secretary.
A vessel deployment is an operational matter for CalMac, but ministers recognise the impact being felt as a result of service disruption. Following requests by communities and sought by ministers, CalMac have reviewed the route prioritisation matrix for the major vessel fleet with the support of the Ferries Community Board. Following public consultation, CalMac made a number of changes to their prioritisation approach, including more emphasis on the level of use by island residents and commercial vehicles, along with higher prioritisation for routes with limited capacity on alternative services, and I fully expect this to be applied by CalMac when considering options.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary. My constituents have welcomed the summer timetable redeployment decisions announced yesterday while MV Caledonian Isles undergoes her extensive repairs. However, CalMac are still exploring another alternative, namely using MV Isle of Lewis on the Uig Triangle, taking her away from Castle Bay to Oban. Can the Cabinet Secretary assure my constituents that any vessel deployed on that last route in this scenario would be more likely to be reliably suitable for such an exposed route than MV Isle of Arran, which was being considered for this route by CalMac as recently as last week?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Scottish ministers note the concerns of communities as CalMac seeks to optimise deployment on the reduced fleet across the summer period until the return of the MV Caledonian Isles. As Dr Allen will be aware, it is the responsibility of the operator to make detailed deployment decisions, although we expect them to take into account the capacity capability, as I've said already, of the vessels as part of that consideration. And we understand that the trials will be taking place next week to further consider the feasibility of this option.
And question 8, Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the improvement plan for the Fife Circle railway line.
Cabinet Secretary.
It was helpful to meet the member last month. Improving the services for Fife commuters is a priority issue for me and my officials at Transport Scotland. I'm pleased that there has been a reduction in short-form services in Fife, which is welcome. However, further work is required. My officials have engaged with ScotRail through Scottish Rail Holdings to require improvements to rolling stock maintenance to make more trains available for service each day. There is a range of work underway to improve services in Fife, and due to the £160 million investment by the Scottish Government, will be looking forward to the reopening of the Leavenmouth line.
Annabel Ewing.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer, and whilst it is welcome news that improvements are evidently in the pipeline, what I think my constituents would want to know, however, is when the improvement plan will in fact be implemented and whether it will address directly the long-standing problems with overcrowding and cancelled trains.
Cabinet Secretary.
So overcrowding in Fife services is due to short forming of trains which serve this route, caused by poor diesel fleet reliability, which is a legacy issue caused in part by poor staffing and fleet choices made by the previous franchisee. My officials have required ScotRail to develop an improvement plan, which is currently underway. It will include issues around fleet availability and a monitoring system. It's now in place and improving useful to direct improvement action. There's a recruitment campaign and related management action that should deliver material improvements with availability of maintenance staff in a matter of months. And there's a number of fleet improvement investments also being identified, which should deliver further improvements over the next 2 to 3 years. But some of the items I've said are more immediate, and I'll make sure that that's put forward in a form that people can see, particularly the member who's pursued this very assiduously.
And briefly, Mark Ruskell.
With new stations being opened at Leven and Cameron Bridge in June this year, rail campaigners across Fife are feeling inspired right now and very hopeful. Key progress is being made in the business cases for St Andrews and Newborough reopenings. So will the Cabinet Secretary congratulate these communities who are leading the way? And does she see a need to expand rail further in Fife to try and get that modal shift away from car usage that we need nationally?
Cabinet Secretary.
There are a number of communities right across Scotland and particularly in the Fife and indeed St Andrews area pursuing improvements and developments for the rail system. I commend the efforts of all those that are involved in Starlink in progressing the transport appraisal for the St Andrews area, which involves considering a range of multimodal transport options. We do want to improve modal shift. It is important that rail is part of that, and I understand that the appraisal for the plan he's just referred to is ongoing and there's no final conclusion to that.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions on transport. Point of order, Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. Earlier in this session, I asked the Cabinet Secretary a straight question as to whether financial considerations were holding up the replacement of the Class 43s. In her response, she suggested, in, I dare say, somewhat intemperate language, that I was wrong and misrepresenting the findings of the Carmarthen Board in relation to those trains. Now, I'm happy to send her a copy of the report, and I refer her especially to Sections 76 and 77, but I especially refer her to the bit that it says, RAIB considers it more likely than not that the outcome would have been better if the train had been compliant with modern crashworthiness standards. I wonder, therefore, Presiding Officer, if you might give the Cabinet Secretary an opportunity to read the report, to reflect on her remarks, to correct the record, and send me an apology.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. That's not a point of order, as you well know. Point of order, Cabinet Secretary.
Point of order. Obviously, items that are said in this chamber are on the official report, and not just my response, but Mr Kerr's original questions this week and last week. I think it's really important we get the safety record understood, and I'm more than delighted to send or resend the letter to Liam Kerr, correcting his misrepresentations today and previously.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That also is not a point of order, but it is now on the record. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.